Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day and welcome to this final part of a video series I've been running looking at taking macro or close-up pictures with Panasonic Lumix Micro Four Thirds systems cameras. Now, in the previous videos we've seen how to use supplementary lenses and extension tubes, and we introduced the concept of using a slider rail to enable us to take slices of our image from the foreground to the background. Now, I was using a traditional slider to show you that, so I thought I'd bring into play today a slider that you might sort of think about purchasing on Amazon. It normally comes as a two-part accessory, so you've got a main slide and you've got a cross slide, which enables you to move the camera side to side, and it gives you a camera mounting point on the top. Now, the only problem with that is you're extending the height of that camera from the mounting point on your tripod. So you're putting a lot of extra load onto the tripod, and the enemy of macro is movement. So any sort of movement you've got in your focus slide, in your camera quick release plate, in the additional slide that you're putting on here, can actually ruin your macro images. So I stripped off that top part and just mounted a Manfrotto quick release plate onto that slide, and then I can just mount the camera onto that. So I've got a very low center of gravity and very little movement between the camera and the plate. So if I switch to the view from the camera, you can see I've got that ladybird again in the flower. As I move the camera up and down, you can see the amount of movement we've got in there, and I'm just flexing this tripod plate by about 3 or 4 millimeters. It's quite a sturdy ball head I've got on this device, although that would be normally attached to your tripod, but I've just got it on the table here. So a sturdy tripod, a sturdy ball head, and all the fixtures and fittings must be tight without any play in them. Now, Manfrotto do a slide plate as well, but I found that to be totally useless. There's too much cross play in that slide if you want to use it for focus stacking. It's all right if you just want to position the camera and then use the in-camera focus method, but if you want to use it for slicing to give you those foreground to background slices, that plate wanders around too much and it makes it difficult for the stacking program to get the images correct. So this slider has a wheel on one side of it, and by turning the wheel you can increment or decrement the position of the slider relative to your subject. It's a geared drive and you've got a clamp plate on the side if you want to put a little bit more tension and stop some of the side play, but you can actually move the camera forwards and backwards. Now, this is all right if you're doing large slices or positioning your camera to use it for the internal focus method we saw in the second video. Now, if you wanted to do slices with 1 millimeter or less increments, you can probably do this, but without much precision. You can actually see the amount of movement you're putting in on the slider by just looking at the scale on the slider relative to a fixed index mark on that slider plate. So you can, to a degree, judge how much movement you're putting into each of those movements. In terms of image movement, let's just look at that. So again, this is the kit lens, the 14-45. It's set at 45 millimeters, and I've got that 10 millimeter extension tube on there. So with a working distance of about 10 centimeters, you can see that I've got the head of that toy ladybird there, and I can move this slider backwards and forwards. So I'm coming away from the front of face, moving into the beginning of the ladybird, and now I can move through, and if I wanted to, get the back of the flower in focus by moving this slide. So I could take my first shot, move it, take my second shot, move it, etc. Using a remote release on the camera if your camera supports it, or you could use the Panasonic Image app to Wi-Fi control the shutter release if you don't have the facility on some of the cameras that don't have a remote socket. Like this GX85 doesn't have a remote socket, you've got to use the 2-second timer or the remote app to control the shutter. Now, we did mention in part 2 of this video the amount of light needed for macro photography if you're going to be using small apertures like f8 or f11 to give you the amount of depth of field you need. Now, in daylight you might just have enough light if it's sunlight or if you're using reflectors to throw some light back into your subject, but it's better to use some additional lighting either by LED lights, or what is commonly used are these LED ring lights. Now, these are advertised as ring flashes, but actually they're not flashes at all, because when you mount them onto your hot shoe of the camera and try to trigger these by the shutter release, You'll find this light comes on and it stays on for about half a second, and during that half a second the camera makes the exposure. So it's not actually the flash duration which is giving you the exposure, it's your shutter speed within the camera. So you might as well leave this light on continuous, and it gives you the idea of where your shutters are falling, the amount of light and where the hot spots are, rather than try and use it in its flash mode. Now these ring lights are battery powered and they consist of something like 36 LEDs on the inside, so this little diffuser softens down the point light source. But unfortunately the design of this one is quite poor. The white reflector here, or the white diffuser, actually is appearing inside the throat of the light. So this actually reflects into the lens and gives you soft contrast. You can get some flaring and ghosting from this. So when I use this, I put a bit of black insulation tape around the outside edge of that so that it can't shine back into the lens. Now you get adapter rings which fit to your front element of the lens. So here I've got the 52mm adapter, and this one just clips in place onto your lens like so. Now they are equipped with two banks of light, a left hand and a right hand bank, and you can individually control them from the flash controller. If I turn on the light, you see the light on the subject. These particular LEDs, and it's true of the three units that I've got here, this one is another one by MCO Plus, uses slightly larger LEDs with magnifying lenses on them, and one of the previous versions of the same device has got a clear diffuser rather than this plastic diffuser. All these have a very green output. If you look at a shot taken with the camera set to daylight white balance and then the light projected onto a white screen, you can see we've got a very green background with a central hotspot. So the illumination from these is very poor. You could actually do a manual white balance. So if you put a white sheet of paper in the front of here while it's illuminated, do a manual white balance, that would get over some of the issues. But the problem is a lot of these LEDs don't have a very high CRI index. So the color rendering index is fairly low. So trying to get color fidelity is something of a hit and miss attempt with these devices. Anyway, let's have a look at the lighting that's been afforded by this device onto my subject. Still got a little bit of studio lights on, but this should be overpowering them at the moment. So let's look at the image from the cameras, and you can see it looks quite green. Let me just bring this into focus a little bit more. You can see those white petals are actually green. Now you can take that out in post-process, but you might as well get that right to begin with and do a manual white balance. So that is a third power. You can actually use the power control on this device to increase the power. So let's just increase the power, and that is going up to the maximum on this unit, which is plus 1.5 EV unit. So we've increased the light output. You can see the working distance, it's given enough light at that distance for a shutter speed. If we just have a look at the shutter speed on the camera, with ISO 200, the shutter speed is 1/25th. So 1/125th at f5.6. So if I were to step this lens down a little more to f8, so we can get a little bit more depth of field, the shutter speed is 1/60th, so there's no way you could handhold this to give you macro shots. They do have to be mounted on a sturdy tripod to give you these macro shots. So let's just capture that image and we can have a look at that in the edit. So that is one of the LED ring lights. That is with the LED on continuous. So let's take an exposure with the ring light just to show you the pulse duration. It's quite long, nothing like a normal flash duration, which might be 1/1000th of a second or even shorter to capture the image. So those are LED ring lights. Let me take this off and we'll have a look at a traditional flash unit. Well, this is a dedicated ring flash for the Canon range of cameras. Works on ETTL exposure, so through the lens exposure metering. But when I'm using it on the Panasonic cameras, I just use it in the manual mode. So I'm not interested in all the other communication electrodes. We're just interested in the center firing electrode. So when this slips onto the hot shoe of the camera, the pulse will be sent from the camera to fire the flash, and it will be controlled manually from the power levels that I'll set on the unit. Again, it's got two banks of flash. Independently, you can set the power levels. Where the LED ring lights, they're either on or they're off. You can't set individual power levels, so you can't do ratio flash exposures. Where this one, I can have one bank on full power and the other bank on half power to give me that 2-to-1 lighting ratio. So you can actually get some better modelling with these flash units. Again, they clip onto an adapter plate that you screw into the front of the lens, and then the flash unit will sit on the hot shoe. So I'll just set this up and we can have a look at the exposures. So I've set up the ring flash on the camera, mounted on the hot shoe. Remember, we're only in the manual mode. If I switch to the view of the actual flash unit, so on the back of the flash unit, you can see we've got our A and B power levels. We've got the power on and off, and we've got the lamp button here, which brings on those modeling lights. So I set the power level to 1/64th, which is probably the right setting for this type of distance. Got the camera set to f11. Let's just drop down to the camera. So we'll take our first shot and have a look at the exposure. Again, 2 second timer. And that looks good on the back of the camera, so we can have a look at that in the edit program. Now, if you are going to be using the focus slide to give you those slices, then obviously you're going to have to take your first shot. And then you'll move the slider by 1 millimeter. Then you take your second shot. Again, using the timer so you're not disturbing the camera position. And then move your third shot. So that's how you build up the individual slices through the subject by using the slide position, moving it forward in 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, or whatever increments you want to give you the coverage that the subject requires. Now, another option is to use a pocket LED light like this one. This is the Poker Light F7. It's an RGB light, so you can use it as a colored light, or you can use it as a white light source or variable color temperature. I've done a review of this, and I'll put a link to the review in the video description below, so you can have a look at it if you're interested in this particular device. I'll switch to the view coming from the camera, and you can see we can use this to set the position of our shadows. So if we wanted to have some three-dimensional look to the image, we can change the shadow position with the light. Or if you wanted to balance the shadows, obviously you can use a white cardboard under the side. Shooting macro becomes a bit of a MacGyver type of situation. You need to work out how to hold your lights in place. If you look on YouTube, there's hundreds of tutorials about lighting for macro, using LED lights, using flashlights, and various contraptions that people have devised to hold lights in place to illuminate the subject, because light is everything in photography. And once you've got the right light and the right composition, you're going to create some better images than just firing willy-nilly and making snapshots. So by use of an external LED light, you can actually determine where the light's going to be and then take your shot. If you wanted to color accent it, then you could use this as a light source. So it's, we backlight this with blue and then take a flash exposure, then you can have some blue highlights from behind. And again, it's your own artistic impressions as to how you want to work with these light sources. Well, there we are, some ideas about to capture some macro images with your Panasonic Lumix Micro Four Thirds system cameras. I've also done this with the Canon M50, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. You can have a look how to set the M50 up using extension tubes and supplementary lenses, just the same way as we did with the standard Micro Four Thirds system. Now, remember, if you're shooting macro, it doesn't have to be looking at the lenses of a fly eye. It could be just getting close to a flower so you can see the detail in it. And then a supplementary lens or extension tubes will allow you to get the camera closer to the subject to fill the frame, which is what we always want to try and achieve with our photography. And again, the use of additional lights or reflectors to make sure that we've got enough 3D depth in there to show the viewer what the structure of that plant looks like. So hopefully you'll try some of these techniques. Have a go. If you want to send me some images, then obviously use your address. So you'll find that on my photographic blog, and I can put a link to that in the video description below if you want to send me some images that you've captured with your setup. So Hope that was useful, and of course if you are a new viewer, please do click that subscribe button and the bell notification icon, and you'll be advised when I upload new videos to my channel. So also check out that photographic blog, and on the homepage is the application to join the newsletter group. And that newsletter group has now gone over 3,600 subscribers, and that letter goes out every 3 weeks or 4 weeks, depending on the time I've got to put it together. It's more than a newsletter, it's more or less a technical publication in many respects. And it's a way of saying thank you for your subscription to YouTube and to the photographic blog, and you'll get some more additional information that I don't publish anywhere else. So that's it for the video. Thanks again for watching, please do take care, and I hope to see you all in the next one. Goodbye for now.